as the sun, and his raiment was white as the light. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elias, talking with him. Then answered Peter, and said unto Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make here three tabernacles, one for thee, and one for Moses, and one for Elias. While he yet spoke, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice out of the cloud which said, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their face and were sore. They were sore afraid. And Jesus came and touched them and said, Arise, and be not afraid. And when they lifted up their eyes, they saw no man save Jesus only. And as they came down from the mountain, Jesus charged them, saying, Tell the vision to no man until the Son of Man be risen again from the dead. Here is the whole myth in a moment. Jesus, the guide, the way, the vision, and the companion of the return. The disciples are his initiates, not themselves masters of the mystery, yet introduced to the full experience of the paradox of the two worlds in one. Peter was so frightened he babbled. Flesh had dissolved before their eyes to reveal the word. They fell upon their faces, and when they arose, the door again had closed. It should be observed that this eternal moment soars beyond Kamar al-Zaman, romantic realization of his individual destiny. Not only do we have here a mastery passage back and forth across the world threshold, but we observe a profounder, very much profounder, penetration of the depths. Individual destiny is not the motive and theme of this vision, for the revelation was beheld by three witnesses, not one. It cannot be satisfactorily elucidated simply in psychological terms. Of course, it may be dismissed. We may doubt whether such a scene ever actually took place, but that would not help us, for we are concerned at present with problems of symbolism, not of historiality. We do not particularly care whether Rip Van Winkle, Kamar al-Zaman, or Jesus Christ ever actually lived. Their stories are what concern us, and these stories are so widely distributed over the world, attached to various heroes in various lands, that the questions of whether this or that local carrier of the universal threat may or may not have been historical. Living man can be of only secondary moment. The stressing of this historical element will lead to confusion. It will simply obfuscate the picture message. But then, is the tenor of the image of the transfiguration? What is the question we have to ask, but in order that it may be confronted on universal grounds rather than sectarian, we had better review one further example, equally celebrated, of the archetypal event. The following is taken from the Hindu song of the Lord, the Bhagavad Gita. The Lord, the beautiful youth Krishna, is an incarnation of Vishnu, the universal god. Prince Arjuna is his disciple and friend. Arjuna said, O Lord, if you think me able to behold it, then, O master of yogis, reveal to me your immutable self. The Lord said, Behold my forms by the hundreds and the thousands, manifold and divine, various in shape and hue. Behold all the gods and angels, behold many wonders that no one has ever seen before. Behold here today the whole universe, the moving and the unmoving, and whatever else you may desire to see, all concentrated in my body. But with these eyes of yours you cannot see me. I give you a divine eye. Behold now my sovereign yoga power. Having faces and eyes. I behold thee infinite in form on every side, but I see not thy end, nor thy middle, nor thy beginning. O Lord of the universe, O universal form, on all sides glowing like a mass of radiance, I behold thee, with thy diadem, mace, and disgust blazing everywhere like burning fire, and the burning sun passing all measure and difficult to behold. Thou art the supreme support of the universe. Thou art the undying guardian of the eternal law. Thou art, in my belief, the primal being. This vision was opened to Arjuna on a battlefield the moment just before the blast of the first trumpet calling to combat. With the god as his charioteer, the great prince had driven out into the field between the two battle-ready people. His own armies had been assembled against those of an uprising cousin, but now in the enemy ranks he beheld a multitude of men whom he knew and loved. His spirit failed him. Alas, he said to the divine charioteer, we are resolved to commit a great sin, in that we are ready to slay our kinsmen to satisfy our greed for the pleasure of a kingdom. Far better would it be for me if the sons of Dhritarsh, weapons in hand, should slay me in battle, unarmed and unresisting. I will not fight. But thereupon the god came and summoned.
Side with thy flaming mouths.
ice and the discus in thy hand. Assume again thy four-armed shape, O thou of a thousand arms and of endless shapes. The Lord said, by my grace, through my own yoga power, O Arjuna, I have shown to you this supreme form, replescent, universal, infinite, and primeval, which none but you has ever seen. Be not afraid, be not bewildered on seeing this terrific form of mine. Free from fear and glad at heart, behold again my other form. Having thus addressed Arjuna, Krishna assumed a graceful shape again and comforted the terrified Pandava. The disciple has been blessed with a vision of transcending the scope of normal human destiny and amounting to a glimpse of the essential nature of the cosmos, not his personal face, but the fate of mankind, of life as a whole. The atom and all the solar systems had been opened to him, and this in turn befitted his human understanding, that is to say, in terms of an anthropomorphic vision, the cosmic man. An identical initiation might have been effected by means of the equally valid image of the cosmic horse, the cosmic eagle, the cosmic tree, or the cosmic praying mantis. Furthermore, the revelation recorded in the Song of the Lord was made in terms befitting Arjuna's castle and race. The cosmic man whom he beheld was an aristocrat, like himself, and a Hindu. Correspondingly, in Palestine, the cosmic man appeared as a Jew. In ancient Germany, as a German. Among the Basotho, he is a Negro. In Japan, Japanese. The race and statue of the figure symbolizing the imminent and transcendent universal is of historical, not semantic, moment. So, also the sex, the cosmic woman who appears in the iconography of the chains, is an eloquent symbol of the cosmic man. Symbols are only the vehicles of communication. They must not be mistaken for the final term, the tenor of the reference, no matter how attractive or impressive they may seem. They remain but convenient means accommodated to the understanding. Hence the personality or personalities of God, whether represented in trinarian, dualistic, or unitarian terms, in polytheistic, monotheistic, or henotheistic terms, pictorially or verbally, as documented fact, or as apocalyptic vision. No one should attempt to read or interpret as the final thing. The problem of the theologian is to keep his symbol translucent so that it may not block out the very light it is supposed to convey. For then alone do we know God truly, writes St. Thomas Aquinas, when we believe that he is the far above all that man can possibly think of, and in the Gina Upanishad, in the same spirit, to know is not to know, to know is not to know. And then to know and to not know is to know. Mistaking a vehicle for its tenor may lead to the spilling out only of valueless ink, but the valuable blood. The next thing to observe is that the transfiguration of Jesus was witnessed by devotees who had extinguished their personal wills, men who had long since liquidated life, personal fate, destiny, by complete self-abdication in the Master, neither by the Vedas nor by penances, nor by almsgiving, nor yet by sacrifice. I am to be seen in the form in which you have just now beheld me, Krishna declared after he had resumed his familiar shape, but only by devotion to me and I be known in this form, realized truly, and entered onto. He who does my work and regards me as the supreme goal, who is devoted to me and without hatred for any creature, he comes to me. A corresponding formulation by Jesus makes the point more succinctly. Whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. The means is very clear. It is the meaning of all religious practice. The individual, through prolonged psychological disciples, gives up completely all the attachment to his personal limitations, idiosyncrasies, hopes and fears, Sometimes.